your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old made new. Jesus, when I met you, you called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave.
Stay. I needed rescue, my sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, and your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave. Glorious day.
Amen.
Mother, do not cry for me. All of this is exactly how it's supposed to be.
I'm right here. Can you hear my voice? My life, my love, my Lord, my baby boy.
As a Naomi to this tree, just know the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be? To have your son and my son killed.
Whatever happened,
whatever happens,
whatever you
don't want to see,
whatever your eyes tell you have become of me, this is not,
no,
not the end. I am making all things new again.
I remember when you were born in that manger where I first held you in my arms. So many miracles and lives you've changed. And this world repays you how? With all this pain.
As they nail me to this tree, snow the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be will to have your son? Son, give.
Whatever happened,
whatever happens,
whatever you see,
I don't want to see,
whatever your eyes tell you has become of me. This is not,
tell me it's not,
by the end. I am making all things new. This is not,
no,
not the end.
Oh.
I am making all things new again.
Okay. So all of that we're going to do over. Are you ready? Just kidding. So all of those people are online right now are going, what? What? See, my dad's hard of hearing, so he thought it was okay. He said, well, that's pretty normal, right? So play the promo that we just shared for those early disciples 2,000 years ago, and here's what you're going to hear. You're going to hear something like this. Look! It's a bird! And that's about as far as it goes. See, you've understood in your life that seeing is not always believing, and sometimes you have to believe before you can see. Does anybody know what that's like? You have to believe before you can see because it doesn't really look good. Maybe in your marriage, you know, you have to believe that God is for you and that he's building in your marriage something that represents his kingdom. Maybe you have to believe that Believe that God is for you, even though it doesn't look like it, and even though it doesn't feel like it, and even though there are times in your lives when you're filled with anxiety and fear and all of this dysfunction that seems to rise to the top. Seeing is not always believing. You got to believe that God is for you and he's not against you, and that he came into this world to pay a price you couldn't pay, and that he loves you. He loves you. More than you can even imagine. John 11:35 is the shortest verse in all the Bible. Let's do a little memorization. Are you ready? John 11:35, the Bible says this. It says that Jesus wept. It does. It says that Jesus wept. So everybody got that one memorized? You good to go? But you need the story behind the story. Really, don't you? You need to know that Jesus went to a friend's house and they told him that his friend was dead, and his response was simple. It was natural. It was human emotion. He did what you would do. And he cried. He wept. You memorize that, right? Jesus wept because his friend died. Now, that's what I always believed, but I think there's more to the story. I'm not sure it was so much that his friend died, because what's about to happen, right? He already knew that he was going to say, hey, Lazarus, my buddy, come out of the tomb. You know, right? Remember that? We talked a little bit, kind of left off there last week. Unwrapping those grave clothes. But I think he wept because of Martha and Mary. And he sensed with his compassion their hurt and their longing and their disappointment. Now you know the two sisters, right? And you've heard this story, but Martha is one of those people. She's kind of impetuous. She's somewhat like, on the Enneagram, she would be one of those people that, you know, she's an organizer, man. This is what we do. I mean, she's got an iPhone, and back in the day, you know, a BlackBerry, and back further, you know, the daytimer, and it's all scheduled out, and this is how it works. Don't mess with the schedule. So some of you are like her, right? Wait a minute. I was pointing the wrong way, right? Some of us are like her. Yeah, Brenda said amen. Did you hear that? Some of us are like that. I mean, we see this structure, and we just got to work this way, man. It's got to fall in line. And then when it doesn't fall in line, man, your whole world is rocked, right? But then there's Mary, you know, Mary. Mary, the one who wants to crawl next to the feet of Jesus and just spend time listening to Jesus. I don't care about the dishes. Man, I don't care about, you know, what needs to be done. It doesn't matter if the house is unkept. It doesn't matter. I want to get into the presence of Jesus. Here's these two personalities, and Jesus loved them both. There's good news for you today. Jesus loves you, regardless of who you are and where you are. But listen to what Jesus said to his friend's family. He said this in John chapter 11, and I'm going to read it beginning in verse 25. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. Now, what's so super cool about that is you have to remember back when Moses said to the Lord, I can't do this. God said, listen, you're going to take my people and you're going to get them out of bondage and you're going to bring them to the promised land. Moses said, not me, God, not today, not anytime. I mean, I don't speak well. I don't know what to do. And what's going to happen when they look at me and they say, who sent you? God said, tell them I am sent you. Do you hear an echo as Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life, and whoever believes in me, underline that if you have your Bible open, whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live, and everyone who lives and believes in me, what? Shall never die. Now here it is. You ready? Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Now by the way, just so you know, let me set the stage here. I'm not talking about an intellectual ascent. I'm not talking about walking a hall of matriculation. I'm not talking about hanging a degree on the wall. I'm not talking about moving a tassel. I'm not talking about your mental capacity to understand. We're not talking about can you cipher or not, Jethro. What we're talking about here goes much deeper than this. We're not talking about the annals of your ability and your cognitive ability to think and overthink. What we're talking about is, do you believe this? I mean, do you believe this in the very fiber of your soul? Do you believe this? Because everybody in this building would say, man, I get it. I believe Jesus, man, good guy. He did it. I believe Jesus, even the cross. He went to the cross. Yeah, I get it. Yeah, and it's Easter, right? It's not just about eggs, right? It's about a risen Savior. I get it. I get it. But do we really believe this? Because here's the thing. If you really believe it, it'll change your life. It'll rock your world. You won't be the same. Do you believe this? Let me prove it to you out of Scripture. There's a question for you today, and it's a question that's the most important question of your life. Do you believe this? The resurrection of Jesus Christ is either smoke and mirrors or it's historical fact. And listen to me. What you believe about this will change your life. So again, let me ask you, do you believe this? Because here's the thing, the disciples were having a little trouble with this. I mean, those guys that actually spent those 3.5 years in that little seminary with the risen Lord, I mean, with the Savior, with the I Am, they're having a little problem with this. And in John chapter 20, it records the story on the first day of the week after the resurrection. Jesus first appeared to Mary Magdalene. Yeah, she's the one that was demon-possessed, had 7 demons, and God had released her from that. Jesus had set her free. Imagine that. And then Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they come along in the Synoptic Gospels, and they're going to report that Jesus appeared to Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James and John and Salome, and the women, they all run, and they told the other disciples, but the disciples did not believe their story. Here's the thing, to the other disciples, seeing is believing. Later on that same day, you might remember, the disciples had gathered together, and there they were. They were afraid, man. They were fearful for their lives, and they've gathered in this room. They've locked the doors of the house, and Jesus just kind of, you know, he does the Jesus thing. Doesn't need the door. Just comes right through the walls. He's standing in the midst, and he says to them, peace to you. I don't know if you're one of those dudes in that room, but you're going, whoa. He just came through the wall. Bartholomew, are you awake over there, man? Did you see this? And then he showed them his hands. And he showed them his side. And he told them, just as the Father sent me, I send you. But Thomas missed the meeting. You know the story. He told the other disciples, I'm not going to believe this unless I see the nail holes in his hand. Now, some of you are already thinking about doubting Thomas, and I don't even like that term. When I see him in heaven, I'm going to say to him, man, you're from Missouri. This is Missouri man, not doubting Thomas. This is Missouri Thomas. He's from the Show Me State. And he's saying, you know, it's some of you are just like this guy. It's not that you don't believe, and not that you do believe. It's not that you just... You know, you just have all this doubt in your mind, this doubt in your mind. It's simply this. You have some questions. And can I tell you something this morning? It's okay to have a question, or 2, or 10, or 100. It's okay to wonder. Yeah, wait, hang on a minute. You see, some of you guys are riding in the truck, and you're saying, whoa, wait a minute. Let's think about this. You know, Jim and I are riding in the truck, and we're saying, just put the pedal to the metal, let's go. And some of you are saying, wait a minute. Why don't we talk a little bit about this, and that's okay. Do you know that God is not intimidated by your questions? Some of you are saying, well, I'm not really sure that he loves me. Okay. Just keep asking the question. He'll answer that for you. Some of you are saying, well, you know, I don't know. After all I've done, man, you don't know me. You don't know my life. You don't know how I've lived. I mean, really, can God use me? I'm going to tell you something. Listen carefully. God can take the most, I mean, heinous, sinful individual, and he can say, man, I got a purpose for you. Living proof. He can do that. He can take you when you're on a road that's absolutely going the wrong way, even when you don't even know it, You're on a detour and you're saying, man, how did I get here? I don't know. I don't get it. Really, does God love me? Maybe you're one of those guys like I've been in my life where you're over here and you're saying, hey, it's all cool, God. I get it. I believe in you. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He's perfect. I get it. It's all good. You stay over there and I'll hang out over here. Maybe that's you. And it's not so much that you don't believe. Maybe it's just that you need to walk a little further. You need to believe deeper in your heart. Let him prove. Because I can promise you this. Listen to me carefully. If you say, God, show yourself to me, he's going to blow you away. He's going to show up. And here's what happens. 8 days later, the disciples are back in that very same room. Same bad time, same bad channel this time. Thomas showed up. And Jesus did his deal, man. He came right through the walls. And he stood there. And what did he say? Peace to you. And I love this part because he looked at Thomas and he said, hey, Thomas, hey, but come here. Take your finger and put it in my hand. And then take your hand and put it in my side. Do you believe this? Here's what Thomas said. Thomas said, oh, my master and my God. Let's take a real quick look at that, will you? Turn in your Bibles to John chapter 20. Turn in or turn on. John chapter 20, we're going to read a little bit. Are you ready? Let's read in the Word of God. Verse 29, Jesus said to him, have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. By the way, if you want to understand when the Bible's really talking to you, underline that, the Bible is talking to you. Listen to what he said. Blessed are those who have not seen. What did he say? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet still believed. That's you. That's me. Let's go on. Then he says in verse 30, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. I'd like to get a hold of that list of things. Wouldn't that be cool? Someday you can ask those questions. Verse 31, but these are written so that you may believe. You hear this word is a theme going on. Believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Do you believe this? I think I already told you, this is written to us. Why do you believe? How do you believe? What do you believe? There was a group of four-year-old children. They were in a Sunday school class in Chattanooga, Tennessee, and the teacher asked the class, does anyone know what today is? One little kid said, yeah, today's Easter Sunday. And the teacher said, super cool. That's fantastic. We're really glad you listened. You understand. But what does that mean? And the little girl just blurted out, well, Easter is when Jesus came forth from the grave. But if he sees a shadow, he'll go back in for 7 weeks. Not quite it, right? Do you believe this? And if you do, let me give you a few things. Here's what it means. It means he's alive. Amen? Here's what the early church did, and let's practice it because we are the church living in the day of grace. Jesus is coming again. Until he comes again, we're the church that is to win people to Christ, to go and make disciples of all nations, preach, baptize, and disciple people. Help them become followers of Christ. Here's what the early church would do. The tradition was this. They would say something like this on Resurrection Sunday, on Easter Sunday. They would say, he's alive. He is alive indeed. It was a tradition that was carried out for years and centuries and over time. And I think it's a good one for us to continue. So let's practice. He's alive. Amen. Let's read it, verse 24, or chapter 24 of the book of Luke. Here's what he says in verse 1. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. Now, before we move too quick, let me ask you this question. What do you think that means? Don't you think that means that they did not believe? You see, Jesus had already told them, hey, I'm going to go to a cross. I'm going to die on a cruel, Roman, rugged cross. I'm going to die. They're going to put me in a borrowed tomb, and I'm going to be in there for 3 days. But then, by the power of God, I'm going to come out of the tomb. Oh! You have peanut butter in your ears. You missed it. Because apparently now you're preparing the body as though it's dead. Jesus. Verse 2. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Whoa! Here you go. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. Verse 5, and as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? get this in verse 6. He's not here. No. But has risen. Remember how he told you. Oh, hey. Do you remember the day? You were in class, you remember? Do you remember the day he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful man and be crucified and on the third day rise? And then the light bulb comes on and they remembered his words. You guys have any light bulb moments like that? Yeah? Yeah. Awesome. Here's what he said. It means that he's alive. He came back to life, and he's alive right now. Get a hold of this, because this is Easter Sunday. But every other Sunday and every Monday and every other day of the week, this statement is always true. Jesus is alive. He's alive. He's alive. And he's present in this place. Now, that get a hold of that. I mean, he's actually alive. You guys with me? And he's here today. Do you believe this? Yeah, I mean, do you believe it? Because the empty tomb has a message. I mean, to science and philosophy, it says explain this event. To history, it says repeat this event. To time, it says blot out this event. To faith, it says believe this event. And of course, there are somebody that's come along and they're going to say, well, you know, nobody really had the body, so he really didn't die. Anybody heard that? There are those, and it began in the 18th century, and it began to gain some traction, called the swoon theory or the resuscitation theory. He just passed out, right? I mean, Jesus on the cross, he just became unconscious. Is that what happened? One lady wrote in a question and answer forum back in the day, dear sirs, my friend said that at Easter that Jesus just swooned on the cross and that the disciples nursed him back to health. What do you think? Sincerely, bewildered. Here's the response. Dear bewildered, beat your friend with a cat of nine tails with 39 heavy strokes, nail him to a cross, hang him in the sun for 6 hours, run a spear through his side, put him in an airless tomb for 36 hours and see what happens. Sincerely, Charles. I love what Donald Gray Barnhouse, one of my favorite scholars, he said this: the angel rolled away the stone from Jesus' tomb, not to let the living Lord out, but to let the unconvinced outsiders in. Oh, that's good. So death could not hold him. Didn't we sing that? Because who he is, he's the Son of God. He's God in the flesh, sinless, the perfect Son of God. And it means this man is who he says he is. And real quickly, that demands a response. So let me ask you again. Do you believe this? Isaac Garrett wrote these words, and he wrote them in 1939. Listen to what he said. He said, the resurrection of Christ is a glorious revelation, but it is at the same time an awful threat to the one who will not accept the fact. The tomb was empty. Why? Because he's alive. He's alive for you. And so that has implications for you. Do you believe this? And if you do, here's what it means. It means he loves you. Listen to this quote in Romans 10:9, and we say it all the time around here. If you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart that Christ, what? Raised from the dead, you will be saved if you believe. So do you believe this? Because on the Sunday after Easter, Thomas, he believed it. I mean, Jesus loved Thomas. He loved Thomas like he loves you. He loved him enough to come to him, to calm his fears, to cure his doubt. And the reason why so many people don't believe, and here's the reason why, is because we've made it so complicated. Can I just say to you this morning that it's not as hard as we make it. I mean, some people want to say, well, you have to be a member of this church or that church, or you're out. You have to be baptized, you know, and you have to do it the way we do it, or you know, it's not going to work. You have to walk like I do, talk like I do the things. And listen, here's what the Bible says. The Bible says, confess with your mouth, believe in your heart that Christ was raised from the dead, and you will be saved. It doesn't say you have to do, you know, dance a jig and jump a pew and slobber and speak in some weird language. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say you have to be a Baptist or a Pentecostal or a Methodist or whatever. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say that, you know, your mom and dad have to be, you know, strong, active members. It doesn't say that. What it does say is you confess with your mouth, you believe in your heart that Christ was raised from the dead, and you will be saved. Do you believe that? Rick Warren, the author of The Purpose-Driven Life, he said this. People ask me all the time, what is the purpose of life? He said he typically responds, in a nutshell, life is a preparation for eternity. So in other words, we are made to last forever. And God wants us to be with him in heaven forever. You see, here's the deal. One day my heart's going to stop, and that'll be the end of my body, but it won't be the end of me. You know, I may live 70, I may live 100 years. I mean, I'm just planning on about 150. Don't know how that's going to work out yet. And somebody said, well, you got to get the clothes off the treadmill to make that happen a little better. Stop eating those big hamburgers and greasy fries, and maybe it'll work out a little better. I don't know how long I'm going to be here, but here's what I do know. I know it will pale in comparison to the trillions and trillions of years that I will live with my risen Savior in a place he's gone to prepare. And so on this side, it's just warm up, man. It's just, this is dress rehearsal. You're getting ready. God wants us to practice on earth what we will be doing forever in eternity. And then that's why I say to people, when you come in here and we sing these praise songs and you sit on your hands and you don't sing it with exuberance and you don't sing it as unto the Lord, listen, you're going to be doing that forever in heaven. You might as well get in on it now and be ready when you get there. I don't care if you can't carry a tune in a tin bucket. Just don't sit next to me, all right? I have enough trouble getting there right, and so don't mess with me. Hey, we're going to spend eternity worshiping at the feet of Jesus. People say, well, why? You know, sometimes, preacher, you preach a little long. And here's the reason why. There will be no more preaching when you get to heaven, so we got to get it done now. The Bible says, by the foolishness of preaching that men come to Christ. You hear me? So we need to preach the Word of God and share the Word of God. We need to practice on this side. That's why you need to practice in your daily life with whatever you do, with whoever you do it with. This is dress rehearsal. Until you figure that out, listen, life isn't going to make much sense. I mean, you need to ask yourself, am I going to live for possessions? Am I going to live for popularity? Am I going to be driven by pressures like guilt and bitterness or materialism? Or am I going to be driven by God's purpose in my life? You see, the message of the empty tomb is that we have a new power to do this thing. I mean, we have a new power here, not only over death, but we have a new power to live in this life. I read about some 9-year-old kids, and they were asked what they thought of death and dying. Let me give you a few of them. You ready? Jim said this, when you die, they bury you in the ground, and your soul goes to heaven, but your body can't go to heaven because it's too crowded. Judy said only good people go to heaven. The other people go where it's hot, you know, all the time, like Florida. John said, well, maybe I'll die someday, but I hope I don't die on my birthday because it's no fun to celebrate your birthday if you're dead. Yeah. Marcy commented something like this, when you die, you don't have to do your homework in heaven unless your teacher is there too. Yeah. Listen to what Paul said about that in 1 Corinthians. He said, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Brett, we need to make that sign. We're going to engrave it. We're going to put it above the nursery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. All right, get with me. Then he goes on in verse 52, and he says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, get this, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable, in verse 53, he says this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, and get this one, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? I love that. Do you believe this? I'll ask the question. Let's do it like this. You know, I like to ask certain people, do you believe this? Do you believe this? Or is this just kind of something that you're not sure about yet? Let me introduce you to some people. You ready? One guy by the name of James, he walked with Jesus. He was an apostle of the Lord Jesus. ask James. Hey, James, do you believe this? Yeah, listen, he was martyred by being burned at the stake as a torch for the nighttime chariot races. Do you think James is going to die for something he didn't believe? No. How about Peter? Don't you love that guy? I mean, Peter's a lot like me. He's a lot like some of you because I know some of you. Yeah, I mean, you're like a bull in a china closet sometimes. Impetuous Peter. I mean, listen, tumultuous Peter. I mean, you, right? You're the one that just prior to the crucifixion of Jesus, you said, I don't really know him. No, we saw you with him. No, you must be mistaken. Wasn't me. I don't hang with him. That's Peter. Jesus had already told him. After Peter said, hey, I'll do anything, man. I'll die for you. I'll do everything. And Jesus looked him in the eye and said, hey, Peter, before the cock crows, you're going to deny me three times, bud. And he did. Oh, how it broke his heart. I love the fact that Jesus never leaves you in that place. Because some of you have been in that place, right? And when you get in that place, just remember Peter. Just remember there's a breakfast on the shore that he's preparing for you. That's what happens. Read the story. He's going to set you down and he's going to say, do you love me? And Peter's still going to be a little bit confused. And he's going to say, yeah, Lord, you know I phileo you. No, Peter, that's not what I'm asking you. Do you love me? Do you agape me? Yeah, Lord, you know I phileo you. Yeah, third time. And isn't it interesting that he denied the Lord three times and Jesus came to him three times with that question? Whoa. There's some significance there. Because he never stops coming to you with his love. He never stops coming to you with his love. I mean, even though you've blown it, right? Even though you've perhaps denied him, even though you've lived in a way that has separated you from his fellowship. And here's what's a beautiful thing. There's a difference between relationship and fellowship. The day you call on the name of Christ and he comes into your heart, you enter into a covenant, a relationship. The book of 1 John says the seed of the Holy Spirit comes to rest in your heart. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit moves into your life. You are now a born-again believer. You are a new creature, according to Paul, a new creature in Christ, one that has never existed before. You have been saved. Of course, John 10, 28 and 29, Jesus says, I hold you in my hand, and no one will pluck you from my hand. My Father who gives them to me is greater than all, and no one will pluck you from my hand. Hey, you're saved. But you don't always act like it. Or is that just me? Right? We don't always act like a child of God. Come on, let's just get real. It'll take off your nice new Easter dress, and don't take it off. But don't think about all that. Think about this. Think about how much he loves you. Even though you're unlovely and unlovable. Think about how much he loves you, even though you've blown it. Yeah. You're Peter. You're like Peter. Now, that's pretty good company. I mean, I'd like to hang with Peter. If I could rise to the faithfulness of Peter, you know, I mean, when he really gets going and walks in faith and grows in discipleship and maturity in Christ, now, wouldn't you like to hang out with Peter? Yeah. He rides a rope glide. I'm going to go with him someday. I'm just saying. You and I need to understand just how much Jesus loves us. And so he comes to him and he says, hey, Peter, yeah, you know, you remember that thing in the garden? Yeah, yeah, I was kind of watching you do that. I didn't know you saw me, Lord. You ever said that? Yeah, I know I opened that book. I shouldn't. I know I was on the internet and I looked at that stuff. But I didn't know you were hanging out watching me. I know, you know. The government must be watching me. They know everything I want to buy and order all the time, so they're sending me ads. But I didn't know, Lord, you were watching. He sees it all. He's omnipresent. He's omniscient. He's everywhere. He sees it. Now, don't let that weird you out. Let that be a sense of assurance. Because if he didn't love you, he probably wouldn't hang out with you. See what I'm saying? So he loves you, and I got to move. That was a whole different message. So here's Peter. And if you went to Peter and you said to Peter, Peter, do you believe this? Now, again, remember, it's after the garden. It's after the breakfast on the shore. Peter, do you believe this? And here's what he would say. Yeah. As a matter of fact, I was martyred on a cross, staring out over the Golan Heights. I said to them, don't hang me the way you hung my Lord Jesus. You hang me upside down because I'm not worthy to die the way he died. You think Peter believed this? Do you think Peter went to his death believing in Jesus Christ's resurrection? He talked to Simon the Zealot. Because we don't give him a lot of press. Simon the Zealot, do you believe this? I mean, you were kind of a wild guy, right? I mean, you were kind of a soldier guy. Simon the Zealot, do you believe this? And you may remember they took Simon the Zealot and they put him on a table and they began to cut pieces of his body off until he died. Simon, do you believe this? Why don't you talk to Jude? Not the Beatles, Jude. Why don't you talk to Jude, the Apostle Jude? Do you believe this? Jude, do you believe this? Do you believe this? He preached in Assyria and in Persia, and he died as a martyr in Persia, believing that Jesus not only died, but he came out of the tomb. Do you believe this? And there's Andrew. Originally, you know, Andrew was a disciple of John the Baptist. But when it came time for him to be martyred for his faith, he said, no, put me on that X-shaped cross. And he died. There's Matthew. I don't know if the chosen got him right, but I think it's interesting the way they did that with Matthew. He was a tax collector. He wasn't very well liked. But he was loved by Jesus. Matthew, do you believe this? Matthew, he suffered martyrdom in Ethiopia by being stoned to death. I don't know. After the first one hits me, I might say, I'm kind of done with this. No. You know why? He believed it. Do you believe it? Bartholomew, do you believe it? He was flayed to death. Paul the Apostle, do you believe it? He was taken and moved, his head was placed on a stone and he was beheaded for his faith in Jesus Christ. Paul, do you believe this? You bet I believe it enough to die for it. Do you believe this? I don't mean do you believe this in some sterile scholastic setting. I don't mean you believe this because you went to Sunday school and VBS. I don't mean you believe this because some preacher said it's true. I'm not saying you believe this because you're a good church-going person. I'm saying, do you believe this in the core of your being? Because it'll change your life. Every one of these apostles, and the only one that died a natural death, as you already know, is John. He's our guy. We're going through 1 John right now. John didn't die a martyr's death. Not because they didn't try. You might remember they boiled him in oil. That crusty old saint came out of that oil alive. They exiled him, you know, to the island of lepers. He got the revelation there and wrote the words. Eventually, he died of old age. Every one of these men believed Jesus died and he rose again and it changed their lives. And they sealed it with their life's blood. Do you believe this? And if you believe Jesus loves you enough to die for you, to conquer death for you, it'll change your life. I read a story many years ago, Billy Graham, which, by the way, I grew up in a home, preacher's home. I was one of those Henri Piquet guys. I only got that because I hung out with the deacon's kids, and they taught me all that stuff. I'm kidding. I probably taught them. Anyway, but I grew up in a home, and my dad said, you got a TV for one of two reasons. One is, if Billy Graham might come on TV and we're going to watch him, right? Number two is the Dallas Cowboys play on TV. That's God's favorite team. That's why there's that hole in the top so God can watch his team, right? I'm just saying. Only two reasons. Billy Graham, I don't know if you've ever been to North Carolina. That's where he's where he lived out his remaining days and went on to heaven. I think it was the year 2000 or whatever it was, and Billy was suffering with Parkinson's disease. You're probably aware of his life story. He was asked by the good people of Charlotte, North Carolina, to come and to speak. And he said, well, you know, I'm not doing as much of that right now. And they said, well, listen, we don't want to, you know, cause you any distress. But we would like you to come so just so we can honor you and celebrate with you. He said, okay, I'll come. And he showed up. And after they had given accolades to the great eagle of evangelism, he came to the platform and he started to speak and he said, I was thinking this morning about Albert Einstein. Albert Einstein apparently at one point in his life was on a train and the conductor was coming around to punch the tickets. You young people, those are different trains, you know, punching tickets. Anyway, just stay with me. It'll be all right. So he was coming around to punch the tickets for those who were riding the train. And the conductor came to Albert Einstein, the great physicist, and said, where's your ticket? And he said, I don't know. And he was looking everywhere for it in his briefcase, under his seat. He was checking all of his pockets. He couldn't find his ticket. And the conductor said, hey, I know who you are. It's all good. I'm sure you bought a ticket, Dr. Einstein. I'm sure it's fine. And he just went on down the aisle. But he turned around and he looked and he saw Einstein on his knees, crawling around all of the seats, looking everywhere frantically for. And he came back and he said, hey, listen, it's okay, Dr. Einstein. It's all right. You don't need to have a ticket. I understand you. I'm sure you bought a ticket. It's all good. Einstein looked at him and said, you don't understand. I need the ticket because I don't know where I'm going. Billy Graham told that story, and then he said, I want everyone to look at my new suit, because he had purchased a new suit. And he said, my family told me that I needed the new suit. My others weren't looking real good, and I kind of lost weight, and they didn't fit me right, and so I bought this new suit. And he said, now, I bought this suit for two occasions. One is to be with you today. The second is I will be buried in this suit. He said, but hey, when that day comes, I don't want you to think about the suit. I want you to remember that I know where I'm going. Do you know where you're going? Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Because it makes all the difference in your life. If you believe this, then you have life. Life, life abundant, and life eternal. I just always think about Easter, and I think about it in these terms. It's not just believing a story, but it's believing that God has given you a gift. And then it's not only believing, but it's also receiving. Do you know where you're going? So I've been asking you this question. I'm going to ask it again. Are you ready? Do you believe this? Do you believe it? Boys, play that video for me, would you?
Truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. God loves the world in this way. He gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Whoever believes in him will not be condemned.
I'm so ashamed. You redeemed me and I just threw it away.
Well, that's not much of a redemption if it can be lost in a day, is it?
Back on my own. They had to come get me. I just can't live up to it.
Well, that's true. But you don't have to. I just want your heart. The Father just wants your heart.
Rejected by others.
I know. But not by the Messiah. Look up. You can.
I'm going to ask you to stand where you are. As you're standing this morning, I'm going to ask that question again. Do you believe this? Do you? Do you believe it? See, preacher, how many times are you going to ask that? You know how many times that question had to be asked of me? You want to play that? Thank you. You know how many times that question had to be asked of me? Because I don't know if you like me. I don't know if you struggle with that. We struggle.